Hiya, welcome aboard. So if you're wondering why it's so dark in here, well, that's because of the curvature of the Earth, but it's also because I'm going to be doing some photolithography, so I've got myself a UV light and a chemistry set. Now, I'm sure if I drank all of these at once, they'd probably sort of disappear in a puff of chlorine. So our challenge, should we choose to accept it, is to print this circuit onto this board and put it in this box. Now, if you're going to be printing the artwork with a laser printer, you're going to need two copies, and that'll fill in any gaps, any imperfections, unless you've got a really good laser printer. So what I've done is I've printed one copy the right way around and one copy as a mirror image. You can see that this connector is over here as opposed to over here, and on the bottom copy I've put the version number. That's a Git revision, but it doesn't really matter. You can use whatever version numbering you're happy with. Now, this is the bottom side of the board. Same thing, we've got normal copy, mirrored copy, but on this side we put the version number on the mirrored copy. Now we're going to cut these out and stick them back to back. So I'm just going to look at this close up and check we've got a good alignment in all four corners. If all the corners are right, then really the whole thing should be right. So after you've stuck them together, this number then performs a second sanity check, and that is whether you're looking at either the top side or the bottom side. If that's reading forward, that's the correct way round for it to be placed against the board. Now, you could add like some more text here to say top/bottom if you needed to. Basically, you're going to need a centre punch, probably a disposable copy of this, because if you punch through it, you put a dent in it. And I would also recommend taping this down to the board. Now, to make that easier, you could make a cutout somewhere unimportant. Because this is going to be a disposable copy, just make a cutout here, maybe here. Tape it down and then punch holes around all four corners of the board and drill them through. Once you've drilled your board, just give it a good scrub with some wire wool. Just get it all nice and shiny. It'll take you a couple of minutes if the board's a bit tarnished. This one I've already sort of done it earlier, so I don't really need much more. I'll give the board just a wipe down with some isopropyl alcohol. You want to avoid sort of working really in the daylight with this stuff because it's sensitive to ultraviolet. You might get away with dim daylight. You can probably tell it's daylight now, but this is just a demonstration. I won't be developing this bit of film. I just want to show you in slightly lighter conditions how we can get this onto the board. So what you need is a piece of glass. This is about the same size. It's from a 6x4 photo frame, and it's about the same size as the actual copper board. And I'm going to unroll this so that as it curls, because it's come off a roll, it wants to go back into a roll shape. So I'm going to unroll it such that it's curling upwards. And I'm just going to tape down three of the corners. And also in this, along the middle of this edge here. Now with this corner, we get two pieces of tape and attach it to either side of the corner like that. And then pull them apart again. And with a bit of luck, yeah, that starts to pull off the protective layer. Now, there are two protective layers, one on each side, and you would think that there would be a 50-50 chance which one comes off, but every time I do it, I get the one I want, I get the top one. And I think that's because of the fact that I'm always having it curling inwards, curling upwards rather than curling downwards, but I've not really tried it the other way to confirm that. If we start to move the glass out of the way, as we peel this back, we can take the pieces of tape off, because it sort of loses its tendency to curl as you pull this strip off. Now, you don't want to be touching the film in the bit that's going to be used, but these edges are going to be discarded, they're going to be cut off, so it's alright to handle it at the edges if you need to. Now, because my work surface is, although it's clean, I've cleaned it with isopropyl alcohol, but it is a bit pitted, so I'm going to put the glass underneath for a straight surface, a level surface. And place the copper board. Copper side down, obviously this is two-sided, but if you're doing one side, then... And now we need to get rid of any air bubbles. Now, bear in mind, you can't just squash them out. They're not just voids. They do contain air, so you do need to get the air out all the way to the edges. So if we just peel that back about halfway. And then I'm just going to work left and right. Well, that might be up and down on your view. But work side to side with my finger, just to squash any air out. Just make sure you get rid of it all. Get rid of it all as best you can, because it will cause problems. So I'm just going to turn this round now and do the same for the other side, the other half, and then we'll just trim the excess off. There is actually a couple of bubbles, I don't know if you can see them, but as this is a demo, I'll leave it at that. Now this side, obviously it's been on the deck and you've had your fingers on it, so it's worthy of just giving it another quick wipe down with the isopropyl alcohol. And then you can repeat the process.
So once the film's attached both sides, pop it into a laminator. I put it through three times in succession.
So what I've made here is a little sandwich which has the copper board at the bottom, the bottom side artwork, could have been either, doesn't matter which side you start with, and then the sheet of glass, and they're all held together by these office clips, and I've made sure that the artwork is aligned to the holes that I made earlier. You won't be able to see them. So we're now ready to expose that side.
So the UV tubes just go into a standard fluorescent light fitting. This one takes 3 12-inch tubes. You need to select a suitable wavelength of UV that's safe for your eyes, especially if it's an ad hoc setup like this. So for that purpose I've used these flycatcher tubes, such as you'll see in a kitchen. Now clearly these are safe to look at. Also make sure that if your fitting has been converted to LED, that you actually use an LED tube, not a vacuum discharge tube. Otherwise, you'll have an explosion.
So with both sides exposed, the next thing is to peel off the remaining protective layers. And the same on the other side. Now warm some water up. This is at 27 degrees. So about 25 to 30 is good. And I'm going to put about 200ml of it in here. Two teaspoons of sodium carbonate. And then plonk that in there. And give it a good scrub. Don't know much about chemistry. There's a song in that. But I'm going to put my fingers in here. It's very slimy, it's like a very slimy alkali feel. La ta 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 ta. History.
So as you can imagine, there's plenty that can go wrong. So on my first attempt, I had quite a few tracks that were just simply missing. Now if you look at the transparency, it's easy to see why. There's been a bit of underexposure, and that's because it's gone a bit shady once the glue that I used to stick them together has dried. So after that, I moved on to sticking them together with water, and then finally vegetable oil, which works just as well as water but doesn't dry out so quick. So at this point I thought it might make things easier if I made my tracks a bit thicker. So there was a little bit of fanning about to do with that, but it wasn't too bad. I've listed all the dimensions in the description below. Another problem I had was resist coming off where it shouldn't do, such as where this screwdriver is pointing now. That turned out to be caused by air bubbles. So having thought that I spent too long developing it the first time round, on the second time round I overcompensated it and did it far too quickly. Now you can see that that's meant some of these clearances around these pads here haven't formed correctly, and also there's a sludgy residue everywhere. One of the advantages of using film instead of pre-prepared boards is that if we get this stage wrong, we can just clean it off and start again, and we don't have to throw the board away. Now you can clean it using sodium hydroxide, which will take a couple of minutes, or you can put it back in the sodium carbonate that you made earlier. That'll take a couple of hours, a bit quicker if you warm it up. Now don't forget to label your chemicals so that you don't get them muddled up with your carrot and swede.
Now one thing I've only just noticed, and that's because now I'm getting a better result. I can actually look at it in more detail and be more critical. You see this here, this is where there's going to be a resistor. Now you can see that track that's going to this pad here is much thicker than these connections that are going to this pad. Now that's because I've allowed Eagle to make the thermal reliefs much smaller than my minimum track size. Now that wasn't deliberate, I didn't realise Eagle would actually allow you to do that, so the next time I do a re-spin of the artwork I just need to beef these up. But overall, if we just start looking at some planes, you can see that there's no bubbling at all. There's one or two, there we go. You can see this imperfection here was probably caused by a bubble. But yeah, it's all about practice, and this is my fourth attempt and it's just so much better than the first one. So the acid test, of course, is to put it in the acid.
So I wanted to raise the board off the deck to allow the acid to get underneath. So I've reattached the office clips. Now plastic clips would be better because of the corrosive nature of the acid, but there you go.
So I'm going to just show you what's going on inside here. So there's water at the bottom, and then I've got the acid inside this container, which I've had weighted down, probably unnecessarily. And I'm guessing that's going to be about the right temperature now. I'm going to very, very quickly take a reading. I don't really want to damage this metal thermometer, but let's have a quick reading. That's reading 43. So it's close enough for jazz. as musicians like to say. And I'm going to give that a quick wipe straight away so that it doesn't start attacking this thermometer. Make a note of the time. It's 15:09 exactly. And then I'm just going to plop that in. And you can't see sod all. So for the next 2 minutes, I'm just going to keep agitating that.
So I can't recommend an optimum etching time because I've only tried it the once, but I was messing about for about 15 minutes, which I think is far too long. After you've finished etching, you need to wash the acid off very thoroughly in water. And then we can get on with drilling the board. Now I'll leave the photoresist in place while I'm drilling, and that just helps protect the copper. Now once the drilling's done, the last step is to clean the photoresist off. Again, you can use sodium carbonate or sodium hydroxide. I used sodium carbonate again, and what I did find is that after I'd left the board overnight, it all went very tarnished, so I ended up polishing it using some non-aggressive metal polish. Now I cleaned all that off with alcohol, but as you'll be able to see in the next scene, it's actually, there's still loads of it stuck down the holes, so it probably needs soaking in alcohol. So a quick look at the finished thing. You can see that the finer details have actually turned out quite well, a lot better than I was expecting in fact. Now there are a couple of defects, such as here, and here, which I've repaired using a wire link. That was actually quite straightforward. Now, since we don't get plated holes with this technique, you will need to fill the vias and solder them bottom and top. Also, some component legs are actually acting as vias, so those will need soldering top and bottom side as well. If this was a fabricated board with plated holes, you'd only need to solder this bottom side. So you need to bear that in mind in your design, because obviously not all components are accessible on the top side with a soldering iron. Now looking at the alignment, you can see that it's a little bit off. Now that's not me having bad aim with a drill. This is actually a misalignment between the top side and the bottom side. And it was caused really by the initial alignment holes that I drilled, which I did early on when I didn't really know what I was doing and I used a hand drill and whatever. So I think it could be much better. I'm not really too bothered about it. For my first attempt, this is quite good, I think. This is where the alignment is worse, but since this component doesn't need soldering on the top, it's going to be easy to deal with that. Thank you for joining me. I hope you learned something, because I certainly did. Give me a like if you found this interesting. If you have a go at it yourself, let me know how you went on in the comments, and I'll catch you again sometime.